Welcome to our next lecture in the series on condensed matter theory. In this video, I want to talk about dynamical mean field theory. And dynamical mean field theory is an approximation to find solutions for correlated electron systems on a lattice, where we use self-consistency, not based on the charge density, as you do in normal mean field theory, but on the Green's functions of the system, such that we are able to describe the response functions of the system in a self-consistent manner, where you can calculate the local response functions and make sure that they are the same on all sides in an approximative way, such that you can still handle the mathematics of the system. So let's see what kind of models we can solve with dynamical mean field theory, and then derive how we can justify the approximations. So we were talking about lattice models, where we have sides I, and they sit on a lattice such that their coordinates are given by integers times a lattice vector, and we have a three-dimensional space, so three-dimensional lattice vectors. So if we just draw our lattice model here in two dimensions, then these are the lattice sides. Now we have a local basis, which we will label by tau. For example, the d orbitals, where tau is an element of d minus 2 up to d2. Then we have a hopping between sides, t, and of course t depends on the orbitals involved and also the distance with which you hop. So in our picture we have the lines between the sides representing the interaction between them, the hopping, and it's an infinite lattice. Then we have a local Coulomb interaction, at side I, the electron can scatter, and an electron with quantum numbers 4 can scatter to an electron with quantum numbers 1, while simultaneously an electron with quantum numbers 3 scatters to an electron with quantum numbers 2. And then we have translation invariance, such that the hopping t tau 1 tau 2 only depends on the difference between the two sides. Note that taking out a single electron from side 1 to side 2 is not a symmetry operation, but only if you translate all electrons simultaneously that is a symmetry operation, due to the Coulomb interaction. So we cannot just make a Fourier transform to solve this lattice. Now the Hamiltonian that we have for our system is a sum over all lattice sides, and instead of T I will be using epsilon for the on-site energy plus hopping, T1 tau 1 tau 2, A dagger I tau 1, A2 tau 2, plus, and then we have the Coulomb interaction, tau 1, tau 2, tau 3, tau 4, the Coulomb parameter, A dagger, A dagger, A, 1, 2, 3, 4. And epsilon ij is epsilon I minus j, and this is a matrix such that epsilon ij tau 1 tau 2 is a single number. And we'll use this matrix notation later on when we start to talk also about the Green's functions of the system, because your local Green's function will also be a matrix. We cannot just solve such an interacting system because of the exponential growing many particle Hilbert space, but if you think of your wave function, then we can write it as a local wave function, the wave function on side I. But the wave function on side I depends on the number of electrons that we have locally, and then for each number of electrons you have a set of states, and we have then also the index over the state. And then we can have charge fluctuations, so we should sum over all possible occupations and all possible states for a given occupation with some prefactor. And then, of course, each local state comes with a state in the rest of the system, which we will call the bath. This is possible for all sides I. And N labels the local occupation. There's also the configuration that we have. And if we have n local orbitals, we know that n goes from 0 to capital N. And j is the state for each configuration. And J is going from 1 to the number of states that we have when we have small n electrons in capital N local orbitals. So that is capital N over N possible many particle states. Now the local wave function is tractable. It's a finite Hilbert space, it might get large. For F-electron systems, you easily have a 10,000 states locally in an F-shell. But it's still doable. The path state is a true many-body state in the sense that you have, well, infinitely many lattice sites with a partial filling such that you have a binomial over infinite, which then exponentially scales up with system size. So this is unrepresentable for real systems. Now, we thus have to go away from representing our systems by wave functions, because there's no way you can represent that wave function. So we're going to focus on response functions. And let's start first with local response functions. Let's start first with linear response functions and single particle. And again, both of these are approximations that we will need to do dynamical mean field theory, but you can go beyond the approximations that we make here. Now, if we look at such a response function, then this is your true many-body ground state, of which we take an expectation value. We have some operator making an excitation. And for the one particles, this would be taking a particle out of the system and placing it somewhere else where it doesn't interact anymore, or taking an electron from some place where it didn't interact and putting it in the system. And then we have two terms, the poles at positive and negative energy within your response function. So those are the objects with which you want to represent our system. Now, the problem with your response functions that are causal and are actually the determining the experimental observables is that they have an imaginary part that is both negative and positive. And if you want to use such a response function as in self-energy in other response functions, then you notice that all poles are below the real axis to make the Kramers-Kronig relations valid, such that you cannot write a response function in terms of a response function of a small system and how the rest of the system responds to it. For that we are going to use the Green's functions, because that is what we want to use. We want to be able to talk about self-energies, and we define the Green's function for site I, orbitals 1 and 2 as a function of frequency, again with two terms, once with the poles at positive frequencies where we add an electron to the system, plus, and then the case with poles at negative frequencies, where we removed an electron from the system. Now, once we know a Green's function, we can always reconstruct the susceptibility. You just look at the imaginary part, or you look at the poles of these functions, and you see that we have to change the sign of that part of the function with the poles at negative energy to go from the Green's function to the response function. So knowing this one, we can reconstruct that one. But the good thing is that in this case, the poles are all below the real axis and the imaginary part is always negative, such that you can use a Green's function as a self-energy in another Green's function. Now, if you look at the state that we have here, then we are looking at the state where you've created one electron in your many-body state locally. And this is the sum over all local occupations and states within that local occupation. And then something where we make locally a change to the wave function at site I. But do not directly change the bath of our system. Now that is good, such that we can think of the response of the system as, first of all, the response locally due to the action that we make on the system, and then in a second step, the response of the bath due to the change that we have on site I. So if we know all the response of site I due to perturbation, then we can think of the change on site I plus 1 as a lattice that is has translation invariance, such that it is the question then how does the site responds to the changes non-locally, and it can either hop in or hop out with an electron, but the response that we have locally by hopping in and hopping out of an electron is already calculated here. such that the idea is that if we know all our local Green's functions, we can then express the reaction of the bath due to a local change, again by these same Green's functions, and find self-consistent conditions for this. So that is the basic idea behind dynamical mean field theory that we will investigate at this point. So due to the fact that we have translational symmetry, we know that the Green's function at site I is equal to the local Green's function at site j. And with that, we will be able to find ways to get rid of the need to know the many-body state of the bath. Now, in order to explain dynamical mean field theory and the approximations that we make, we will start from the mean field approximation. And in mean field theory, our Hamiltonian is going to be approximated by a potential in which the electrons move. And now, because we have a periodic system, the Hamiltonian is periodic on the one-particle basis, such that we can Fourier transform. And we find that after that unitary transformation, the Hamiltonian in k-space is diagonal as a function of k, the crystal momentum. We can now calculate our Green's function for the mean field Hamiltonian in crystal momentum space as a function of frequency, and that is our mean field ground state, which is just filling up all the one particle orbitals up to the Fermi energy. And then we have two terms, one where we first create the Hamiltonian and then look at the propagator on the ground state energy in mean field theory. And a term where we look at the electron removal spectrum at negative frequencies, so a pulse at a negative frequency. Yeah, on the dagger, tau 1, psi 0. We can solve this, and what you find is that this is just the band structure, or the poles of this function are the band structure. You have poles at the eigenfrequencies of the one particle Hamiltonian. And this is an n by n matrix. So here I shoot in at the indexes tau 1, tau 2. So this is an n by n matrix, where n labels the number of local states that we have. We can also calculate the local densities of states at site I, and that is just given as the integral over the Brillouin zone of the Green's function in k-space. Now, in order to go from the mean field Green's function to the Green's function of the full system, we'll define a self-energy. And we'll define the self-energy as gk 0 of omega minus 1, so the inverse of the mean field Green's function minus the inverse of the full Green's function. And again, these are matrices, so this is a matrix inverse. With that, we can also define the full Green's function as 1 over the mean field Green's function inverted. Minus the self-energy. And if we now fill in the equation for the mean field Green's function, then this is omega minus epsilon k minus the self-energy plus I zero plus. And with that we can also define the local full Green's function as the integral over the Brillouin zone omega minus epsilon k minus the k-dependent self-energy plus a small imaginary part. Note that this is an exact representation of your many-body Green's function. Just because we defined the self-energy as this difference, the rest follows exactly. So we haven't solved anything yet. Now we're going to make the important approximation that makes dynamical mean field theory workable. And we're going to make the approximation that our self-energy sigma k of omega is k independent. Now there will be many cases where this is not a valid approximation. But if you think in the case of ligand field theory, there we approximated our solid by a single atom interacting with a mean field approximated ligand. In this case, if you would just paste several of the kind of systems together and the response functions of these systems together, then you would get that your self-energy is local. So it is definitely an improvement over what you did in ligand field theory. So what we do is we have local clusters with all their interaction and we couple them together, where we now not have a mean field approximation of each side, but a dynamical mean field approximation of each side. Locally, we keep all interactions. Non-locally, we neglect the k-dependence of the self-energy. Now, once we did this, you will find that the local Green's function becomes an integral of omega minus epsilon k 0 minus sigma of omega plus I 0 plus d3k. And this is just the mean field local Green's function evaluated at omega minus sigma of omega. So we can now do the integral with a self-energy in the same fashion as we did the integral without self-energy, but we just have change of the coordinates at which we evaluate this Green's function. In order to remove the need to calculate the ground state wave function of our bath, we will map a full interacting lattice model onto a non-interacting lattice model such that the Green's functions of both are the same. Now for this we will first have a look on how we can map a general lattice model onto an Anderson impurity type of Hamiltonian, which is just a unitary transformation of the basis states, and then use this to introduce also a self-energy and see how we then can work with the Green's function of the full system that should be equivalent to the Green's function of a mean field approximated system or a non-interacting system. So what we have is on a mean field level, where I will start to explain the equations that we will use, a lattice model. And we want to map this onto a model where I have a single side interacting with a bath that is diagonal on the single particle interactions. So each circle here represents a site, and each line is an interaction. So we map a lattice to an Anderson impurity model. Where this represents the bath, and this site I. And the site I is truly one of the sides of the lattice, and of course the bath sides are linear combinations, unitary transformations of all others. So all these become equal to those. In order to do this, we can define the hybridization function as omega minus the local mean field Hamiltonian minus the local Green's function inverted. We have the energy dependent hopping, which is the square root of the imaginary part of the hybridization function delta. And then we can define our local Green's function of the lattice or of site I that are equivalent to each other. Omega minus epsilon I, which are the local interactions, minus. And then we have an infinite number of sites to which we can hop in our Anderson impurity model. And the hopping amplitudes are given by T and frequency dependent. And then we have a pole at omega prime at the energy where we hop to. And we have to integrate over all bath sets. Now this picture represents a tight binding Hamiltonian. This was site 8. And the tight binding Hamiltonian is given as a sum over all local orbitals, epsilon I, tau 1, tau 2, a dagger tau 1, a tau 2. In this case, I will still write down the Hamiltonian. I will, for later cases, will just work with the pictures representing your tight binding Hamiltonians. A sum over all orbitals, a sum over all sites in our bath, which are given by the energy of that site, and then the on-site energy. And our bath sites are purely diagonal. And then we have the hopping between the local site, which corresponds to a real site in the lattice, and the bath. So each local site or can hop, the local site can hop to bath sites with hopping amplitude T of omega to a bath site at energy omega. And we have to integrate over all omegas. And what you have here in purple is just a unitary transformation of all sites that we have around the site where we have our impurity. Now let's see how we can use this to transform our Hamiltonian with interactions to an Hamiltonian where we have no interactions, such that the local Green's functions stay the same. Because what we did before was for a mean field approximated Hamiltonian. So we know that the Green's function for an interacting system is given by the Green's function of a mean field approximated system of omega minus the self-energy, where we assumed that the self-energy is local. Now, what we have seen before is that we can write our local Green's function in a form where we can read off an Anderson impurity Hamiltonian, where we have an on-site energy and an hopping to the other sites. So this is 1 over omega minus epsilon I, well, minus the self-energy, minus the integral, minus infinite to infinite, the hopping, at energy omega prime, 1 over omega minus sigma of omega minus omega prime, our hopping matrix element, d omega prime. So we now have a tight binding Hamiltonian representation, but instead of calculating the Green's function at energy omega, we have a minus sigma of omega on each side where we have our interactions. So we have an energy dependent on-site energy, of omega dependent on-site energy in our tight binding Hamiltonian. Now we can rid of this by adding additional sites. We can always write our self-energy as a continued fraction, where the alphas and betas can be matrices of the same dimension as your Green's function, omega minus alpha 1 minus beta 1, of omega minus alpha 2 minus beta 2, etc. If you think of such a continued fraction, you would get the Green's function of a system, or if I take a one-dimensional chain, then the Green's function of its endpoint corresponds to this continued fraction. If we have an on-site energy alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and a hopping beta 0, beta 1, beta 2. So the circle is the real side that we have, and then the diamonds are the additional sides that we add to represent the self-energy. So if we start from a tight binding model, with local Coulomb interactions, then original, we had a tight binding model where we have sites given by open symbols, and I use the squares for the local site with Coulomb interaction. So there we have an interaction U, A dagger A dagger AA, where two electrons locally can scatter. And we have, as lines, the hopping between sites. Now we can make a mean field approximation. Then we keep the same geometry, we keep the same hoppings, but locally we just have a potential. Now we can make a unitary transformation where we keep one side as it was but make linear combinations of all the other sides, and that will bring you to a geometry where you have a local site and a path. We did linear transformations when you go from real space to K-space, or unitary transformations. Here you diagonalize the system except for a single site. Now we're not interested in a mean field approximation, but we want to have the full interacting lattice systems. So as a next step, we can add the local self-energy. We still have our sites. The bath in principle is infinitely dense. And now if you look back at the equations for your Green's function, then you find that at the local site with onset energy epsilon I, we add a self-energy, but also to all bath sites we add a self-energy. It's noticeable that the numbers of sites that I have here is equal to the number of sites that I have in my lattice model. So your one particle Hilbert space has in these two models the same dimension. So here we still have the one particle lattice model with the same dimension as before, but we are now going to add lattice sites to represent the self-energy. And we make nice diamonds. And we added additional sites that represent the self-energy. Now it's very important to realize that we increased the dimension of the one particle Hilbert space here. So if you have a correlated lattice system and you want to map it to an Hamiltonian of an uncorrelated lattice system, then the size of your correlated Hilbert space is given by in how many ways can I put n electrons in capital N one particle orbitals. If you then map it to an uncorrelated system where the Hilbert space size just scales with the number of sites, and you want to have an exact mapping, then you have to increase the numbers of sites, and that is exactly what we did here. Now, because we assumed that the self-energy is local, you will find that each real site will get a one-dimensional chain representing the self-energy. In realistic systems where the self-energy has a k-dependence, there should be interactions between all self-energy sites. Now, we can make an additional unitary transformation just to show you the physics of the transformations that we, in the substitutions that we made. Whereas this is the one that you mathematically would use in your calculations because it's the easiest numerically. We can redo or undo the unitary transformation that we did, going from a lattice to an Anderson impurity model and go back to a lattice. And what you find is that your mean field approximated lattice now is coupled, each side coupled to a one-dimensional chain. Of diamonds representing the self-energy of that system. And this system has the same local Green's function. As are interacting many body Hamiltonian, where we have true correlations on each side. as we now have mean field, local sites. So the Hamiltonian is given by A dagger ace, whereas the full interaction has Coulomb interaction, given by A dagger AA. So a system like this, you can make a transformation on the orbitals such that it becomes diagonal. That doesn't work for a fully interacting system. Now what we have shown is that there is a transformation and there is a self-energy such that you can map one to the other and get the same local Green's function. We have not discussed how we can determine the self-energy. And for that we can have a look at this model, and we going to replace one site where we keep the Coulomb interactions, and all other sites will be approximated on an, or will be represented by a self-energy. So this is the correlated site. That is the mean field site plus a self-energy. Such that when you calculate the one particle Green's functions for the full lattice system or locally, you will get the same self-energy. And that is the self-consistent condition that we're going to make. You're now going to calculate here your Green's function. From that you can calculate the self-energy, and then you can put the self-energy in the rest of the lattice, and that of course needs to be self-consistent. So you start by assuming a self-energy, then you calculate the local Green's function of such an Anderson impurity model, and for that you will go to this geometry because there you can easier integrate over energies. And then we're going to determine the local self-energy, and this has to be done self-consistently. So this is a very similar self-consistency loop that you have in density functional theory, where you do the self-consistency on the density, and here you do the self-consistency on the self-energy or the one particle Green's function. Now if we apply this approximation to a lattice model, then at u equals zero, you have some energy to momentum distribution and some densities of states. Note that my band structure and densities of states do not match. That is to show you that it's just a model, and we have a bandwidth W. Now when our interactions are roughly on the same strength as W, you'll find a modification of your one particle densities of states, so the densities of states or minus the imaginary part of the local Green's function now gets a central peak that has a smaller width than the original bandwidth, and we get original sidebands. And you find that the central peak still has a nice dispersion, whereas the sidebands become reasonably K dependent. There is some dispersion in there depending on the model and the hopping that you have. The band that is given by some quasi-particle, because it's sharp, has a long lifetime, we will call the coherent state, or the quasi-particles. Whereas the diffuse spectral band we call the incoherent states. Now, if we go to the limit where the Coulomb repulsion is much bigger than the bandwidth, you will find in your densities of states two replicas of the original densities of states split by an energy U, each with a width W, and they have, as a function of momentum, some incoherent behavior. And we see now also that you can go from a metal to an insulator as a function of the Coulomb energy strength that you have locally. So this is one of the successes of the dynamical mean field theory, that you can represent these kind of metal insulator transitions and get a handle on correlated electrons on a lattice. So that is of course very nice for open D or open F shells. So I hope to have given you a brief overview of the dynamical mean field approximation or dynamical mean field theory. Solving such an Anderson impurity model is still by far not trivial. If you allow yourself to give up some accuracy on the real axis, then there's definitely methods that can do it, but if you want to be highly accurate, that is still a work in progress. But there's some nice development in this field, and it's getting better every time. Furthermore, we of course now have only a self-consistency on the local one-particle Green's function. You can now also ask, how can I make a self-consistency on the two-particle Green's function, or the nonlinear response of the system? And if you would have all the responses self-consistent, then you will retrieve the exact theory, which of course is very nice, because this allows you to really go to the exact limit without ever needing to know the Bath wave function. So you get away from this exponential scaling that results into something that is fully not representable, into a theory that you can systematically enhance upon in a way that, well, its scale's not very nice, but it is at least tractable up to a bit higher order than just the dynamical mean field approximation. Thank you very much for your attention. Stay healthy. We see each other later.